Electrical conductivity of materials, right. In electrical conductivity of materials, first thing what I would like to introduce is the concept of resistivity. What is the difference between resistance and resistivity? Resistance, you all know, comes from the Ohm's law, okay? V equals to IR. If you have a current carrying conductor, the potential difference between two ends is if V and I amount of current passes through it, then we can write using Ohm's law V equals to IR or R equals to V by I. But this is resistance, its unit is ohm, its units is ohm. But then why it is required to familiarize with the resistivity? Who can tell?
It is the property of material, specific property of materials.
Right, very good. Basically, the resistance is the material dependent, shape dependent characteristic, shape dependent. If you have different types of shapes, the resistance will be different, okay? But for resistivity, it is the intrinsic property of the material which is fixed for a material. Let me discuss this thing. R equals to V by I. Another thing you know, that R equals to rho into L by A, that you know. What is this? Which one? Rho. L is length and A is the area of cross section of the material, of the conductor, right? R equals to rho into L by A. Now, let us have some small mathematics. R equals to rho into L by A and R equals to V by I. So, if you put V by I here, V by I equals to rho into L by A, okay? V by I equals to rho into L by A. Here, let us have this kind of a structure, that V by L equals to I by A into rho. Can I write? V by L equals to I by A into rho. What is V by L? It is electric field, it is E, equals to what is I by A? Yes, it is denoted by J, okay? Current per unit area. If the current is in ampere and area is in, say, centimeter square, then ampere per centimeter square is the unit for J or the current density, and it is rho. Rho is basically 1 by sigma the conductivity. Rho is equals to 1 by sigma the conductivity, okay? Therefore, J equals to sigma E. So, this J equals to sigma E is another form of Ohm's law. This is another forms of Ohm's law, which is not material dependent. This conductivity sigma or the resistivity rho is the intrinsic property of the material, and its unit is ohm centimeter for resistivity. Resistivity unit, what is the unit of resistivity? Ohm centimeter. You can calculate from this relation. You can calculate from this relation R equals rho into L by A. So, what is rho? Rho is ohm centimeter basically, because length, you see that length is in centimeter and area is in centimeter square and rho. So, centimeter rho by centimeter, R equals to rho by centimeter or rho equals to R centimeter, that means ohm centimeter, okay? So, resistivity is ohm centimeter and obviously, the conductivity will be ohm centimeter inverse, 1 by rho or 1 by ohm centimeter. Now, let us have some conductivity, electrical conductivity of some materials. Let us discuss about the electrical conductivity of some materials. Let us start from metal. Okay, let us start from metal. What is the electrical conductivity of say silver? What it is value?
10 to the power 7.
Yes, say around 6 or 7 into 10 to the power 7 of the order of 10 to the power 7. Okay. Then it is
copper.
How much?
10 to the power 4.
10 to the power 4 or 6? 10 to the power 6. Okay.
Gold
10 to the power 4. Then aluminium 10 to the power 4. So, those values are there for the conductivity of this metal. Okay. Another set of metals, say ceramics metal, say concrete, what is the value? 10 to the power minus 9, concrete is minus 9. Porcelain, 10 to the power minus 10 to 10 to the power minus 12, right. Say nylon, 10 to the power minus 12, 10 to the power minus 13. Okay. Then polystyrene, it is 10 to the power minus 14, all in ohm meter inverse unit, remember. So, what we see that the metals are very conducting so far as the electrical conduction is concerned. And this concrete, porcelain, nylon, polystyrene, etcetera, those are basically insulator in nature because the conductivity is very, very less. It is almost there is no conductivity in it. So, those are insulator, 10 to the power minus 12, 10 to the power minus 14, so almost there is no current that can be conducted through those material. Okay. Let us take another example of silicon, it is 4 into 10 to the power minus 4. Then gallium arsenide, it is 10 to the power minus 6, right. These are known as semiconductor, whose conductivity basically lies between that of metal and insulator. So, now in terms of band diagram, in terms of band diagram, if I would like to explain the metal, semiconductor and insulator, then how I can explain? What is the difference in band gap between the metal and the semiconductor and an insulator? But what is in between? What is in between? What is there above in between and below in between?
So, band gap for conductivity?
For no, band structure, because I have to explain these result on the basis of the band diagram in materials, because ultimately what is the origin of such kind of value? The metal conducts very heavily and much more than semiconductor or the insulator. Yes, but availability of electron, but from where the electron will come? Right. So, that means what you are telling, basically there are two bands, one is known as the valence band, another is known as the conduction band. As the name implies, conduction band basically determines the conductivity. All kinds of electrical conduction will take place in the conduction band. So, unless there is electron in the conduction band, the material cannot be used as a conductor. So, the precondition is that you must have free electrons in the conduction band. You must have free electrons in the conduction band to have a conductivity of the material. But from where that free electrons will go to the conduction band? Because the general idea is that the conduction band is empty, and the valence band is full. Why? Because from where the electron will come? Yes, from the valence band basically. Outermost orbit means valence band, right? So, from the valence band the electrons will come to the conduction band. So, the origin of electron is in the valence band. That is why we tell that the valence band is full at 0 k and the conduction band is empty. And you need some force, some electrical mechanism or say some excitation, be it electrical, optical or anything, heat, so that some of the electrons jumps from the valence band to the conduction band. To have some free electron in the conduction band, which will give you the conductivity of the material. So, in terms of band diagram, I can tell that basically there are two bands. One is known as the conduction band, another is the valence band. Generally, the bands are parabolic in nature. And if you plot the band in EK diagram, what is EK diagram? EK diagram is along y axis energy, along x axis propagation vector k, which is nothing but the momentum. I shall show you how k and p is related. Yes. So, basically if you tell that it is a propagation constant or wave vector, so the general idea is that it is momentum, because for physics students it is very easy to conceive the idea of that h cross p k etcetera, but for other students momentum is very easier to understand. Okay. So, that means in the x axis it is basically the momentum or the energy wave vector, the wave vector or the propagation vector. In the x axis it is the energy, and the bands will look like this. It is basically the parabolic in nature. Okay. You see that there is a bottom or the minima of this band, that is known as the conduction band minima. Similarly, there is a top point or a maximum point for the valence band. Okay. That is known as the valence band maxima. And the distance between the top of the valence band and the bottom of the conduction band is known as the band gap of the material. So, band gap of the material is nothing but the energy distance measured in energy, the distance which is measured in the unit of energy. Here you see that it is, yes, say it is E 1 and it is E 2. So, difference between E 2 and E 1 is the band gap, E 2 minus E 1, right. So, band gap means the energy difference between the top of the valence band and the bottom of the conduction band. So, when we draw two lines to denote the band gap, this is CB, it is VB, CB is the conduction band, VB is the valence band. That straight line basically the top and the bottom positions, So, generally we use two straight line, parallel two straight lines, parallel lines to denote the band, two bands. So, this line that is the bottom of the conduction band and that is the top of the valence band. Yes? Why these are parabolic in nature? Then we have to solve the Schrodinger wave equation and other type of formalities. Okay. So, I am not going into details all such things. So, basically this type of band and this is the band. Okay. So, these two bands are involved in conduction process for semiconductor. For metal, what happens? The bands overlap. The bands overlap. Generally, in the valence band, there is full of electrons, and conduction band it is empty. Okay, but for metal, say this is the conduction band, and that is the valence band. So, in some portion, the band overlaps. Some portion the band overlaps. What is the implication of overlapping? The implication of overlapping is that already there are some free electrons in the conduction band, because you cannot separate, they are overlapped, they have touched, right. So, since there is a overlapping, so already there are some free electrons in the conduction band. That is why metal conductivity is very, very high. Already there are electrons to conduct current in the material, right. Then for insulator, this is the band gap Eg, E suffix G, and you see that the gap is wide. The gap is wide. You can tell me, sir, how wide it is. It may be 3 electron volt, 4 electron volt, 5 electron volt, 7 electron volt, 8 electron volt. Okay? I cannot say any cutoff value. I cannot say any cutoff value, because there are several wide band gap semiconductors which have very high band gap. Even then, they are known as the semiconductor. There are some ceramic material, particularly electro ceramics, whose band gap is small. Even then, they are regarded as the ceramic material. So, that is why I shall not go into any cutoff value, that what should be the cutoff for semiconductor, what should be the cutoff for the insulator, but it is several electron volts. Several electron volts mean it may be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 electron volt. And for semiconductor, this value is less. This value is small. Okay? Then what is the implication of such a small value? The implication of such a small value is that even at room temperature, what is the thermal energy at room temperature? What is the thermal energy at room temperature? It is kT. It is kT. What is k? It is Boltzmann constant. What is its value? 1.3 × 10⁻²³. And what is the value of T at room temperature? 300 K. So, if you multiply 1.38 × 10⁻³⁸ multiplied by 300 electron volt, no, what is the room temperature? It is 26 milli electron volt. It is 26 milli electron volt. The thermal energy at room temperature is 26 milli electron volt. 25.9 precisely. Okay? So, at room temperature, this value is always there, that is known as thermal energy. So, when the band gap is small, the valence band electrons can gain energy from the thermal source, okay? And they become energized. They jump from the valence band to the conduction band, so that at normal room temperature in semiconductor materials, always there is some free electrons in the conduction band. Okay? So, the idea is that the gap is so small, because we have seen that what is the gap in germanium? It is 0.67 electron volt. 0.61 electron volt is very small value. Even for narrow band gap materials, indium antimonide, gallium antimonide, it is even less, 0.18, 0.19, 0.17 electron volt. Right? So, the value is very small. So, that at normal room temperature, the electrons in the valence band will gain energy from the thermal source, and they will jump from the valence band to the conduction band, so that you will get some free electrons in the conduction band even at room temperature. That is why those materials are known as semiconductor. In conductor, they are overlapped. In semiconductor, they are not overlapped. Okay? In semiconductor, they are not overlapped, but at normal room temperature, because of the thermal energy, you will have some energy in the conduction band, which will give rise to conductivity of the material. That is why they are known as the semiconductor. Remember that at 0 K, at absolute zero temperature, a semiconductor will act as an insulator. A semiconductor will act as an insulator, you will not get any free electron in it, right? But in case of insulator, the gap is so high that even at normal thermal energy, no electrons will move from valence band to conduction band, because say the difference is 4 electron volt or 6 electron volt. 4 electron volt and 6 electron volt is very high energy so far as an electron is concerned, right? And so, at normal room temperature, you will not get any free electron in the conduction band of the insulator. That is why they are insulator. So, the idea is that you have some free electrons in the conduction band of the material to get some conductivity out of it. Unless there is free electrons, you cannot. Okay. So, this is the difference between the metal insulator and semiconductor so far as the band diagram is concerned. Remember that these are the basically freehand sketch of the band diagram. It is a parabolic in nature, but we can use a straight line or that type of a block to put forward our idea, right. Now, another thing is that the relation which I have shown you earlier, that lambda equals to 1.24 by E g. Okay. Can you remember that value? Yes, that thing. It is 1.24 by E g. From where this relation comes? No. From where this relation comes? How can I say that lambda equals to 1.24 by E g? Is it God gifted? No. Then? Yes, exactly. Exactly. E equals to h nu, nu equals to c by lambda. Okay? This c is the velocity of light. Its value is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. Then h is Planck's constant, whose value is joule second, and lambda is your wavelength, this lambda. Okay? And if you put the value of h and c and simplify, and then this use this unit electron volt and micron, then you will get lambda equals to 1.24 by E g. If you do not take it micron, then there will be additional terms, 10 to the power something. Okay? If you do not use electron volt and use joule, then there will be a difference of 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. right? So the conversion of unit is very important in this case, and this relation comes from E equals to h c by lambda, and if you put h and c, then you will get this value. Okay. Now, this is the band gap E g. So, if this is your band gap, so how much energy is required to excite one electron from the valence band to the conduction band E g? The minimum amount of energy is E g. Very good. Minimum amount of energy is E g. You need at least E g. You need at least E g. So, let us take another example of say gallium arsenide. Say this is the conduction band and this is valence band, and the value is 1.43 electron volt. Yes? Yes, very good question. Very good question. He has asked me what is there in the band gap. Is there anything? No. Ideally, there is nothing in the band gap, that is why it is known as the forbidden gap. Ideally, there is nothing in the band gap, it is forbidden gap. Ideally, remember, ideally. No, ideally, it is not possible. But in real crystal, when we talk about a semiconductor or a ceramic or some material or say polymer, because one important application of polymer is in electronic device, you know that the organic semiconductor devices, though those are polymer materials, but their conductivity is even comparable to the metal in some cases, fantastic large conductivity, and people have exploited those huge value of the conductivity to use them in electronic device, particularly in light emitting diode, flat panel display, then photovoltaic device, that is solar cell, already it is there. So, for large area device. Okay? So, I shall discuss those things in detail in some later classes. So, what is there in the band gap? Ideally, there is nothing, but any crystal, whatever precaution you take, you cannot avoid impurity in it. You cannot avoid impurity in it, right? Say if you want to make a silicon crystal, we shall discuss those things. If we want to make a silicon crystal, what is the starting material? The starting material is the sand. The starting material is the sand. That is why it is cheap and inexpensive. Okay? But there is some chemical treatment for its purification. Okay? After purification, there is a process known as the crystal growth process, bulk crystal. There is epitaxial crystal also, that is a separate issue. So, first a material is purified and the crystal is grown by some methods of crystal growth. If you take a sample of that crystal, whatever precaution you have take, you take, there may be some impurity in it. Okay? And that impurity will have its energy level in between the bottom of the conduction band and top of the valence band, that means in the band gap. So, in the band gap, there can be electronic level. In the band gap, there can be electronic level. That is a separate story. Electron is very choosy. Electron is very choosy. Unless it has some specific room for it, it will not move. No, no. Forget about the radiative, non-radiative type of thing. Electron for the destination, suppose you electron will jump from valence band to conduction band. In the conduction band, there must have a level for it. If all the levels are full, then it will not move. It will not move. And also you know that because of the spin, plus half and minus half, in one level how many electrons can stay? Two. So, if suppose this is a material, in its band gap it is say there is no electronic level, in the conduction band there are only two levels. Theoretical consideration, how many electrons can move? Yes, at the most 4 electrons can move from valence band to conduction band. How many electrons are there in the valence band? It can be 10 to the power 17, 10 to the power 18, 10 to the power 19, 10 to the power 23. Okay? So, only 4 electrons will be able to move to the conduction band. So, that is why I tell that electrons are very choosy. Top of the valence band, how? Is the gap is 10 electron volt?
Yeah, between the, okay.
No, no, the band gap is 10 electron volt, or what you are talking about?
The energy level where the valence band lies.
No, no, valence band lies means that is the difference. When we talk about the band gap, it is the difference in energy.
Okay,
it is a difference in energy.
Suppose the band gap is 10 electron volt.
Yes.
Yes,
that I am telling. Suppose the band gap is 10 electron volt and you are would like to supply 5 electron volt of energy, then nothing will happen. The electron will not move, because for the movement of electron, at least actually I have started that thing. See, 1.43 electron volt is the band gap of the gallium arsenide. Okay, 1.43 electron volt. Now, for sending an electron from valence band to conduction band, at least 1.43 electron volt energy is required. So, if the energy is less than 1.43, no electron will move, no electron will move ideally. But if there is an electron level in the forbidden gap, there is an electron level in the forbidden gap, which I have shown you using a dotted line with a broken line, that is known as ET. What is that? No, not Fermi electric. That is basically a defect level. Okay? That is basically the defect level. T stands for trap, T-R-A-P. Trap level. Why trap level? Because because it can trap an electron. Yes. So, if the energy is less than 1.43, but you have provided sufficient energy to reach to ET, then one electron or the electrons can move from the valence band to ET level or the trap level. That is all. But provided there is a level there. So, ideally there is nothing in the band gap, it is completely forbidden gap, but due to the fabrication or processing of materials, unintentionally there can be level in the material in the band gap, which can act as the defect level. So, in the band gap you can find other levels as well. So, when I talk about the level, it is basically the energy level. It is basically the energy level, a part of the EK diagram. If there is a level, then electron can reach there. If there is no level, electron will not move. Another consideration is that this level in the band gap can be intentional or unintentional. Can be intentional or unintentional. In intentional case, basically, if you dope a semiconductor, intentional means doping. Okay, intentional means doping of the material. If you dope the material, then the material can be converted into P type or N type. Remember, the material can be converted into P type or N type material. So, intentionally you have added impurity in it, right? Intentionally you have added impurity in it. That is the case for doped semiconductor. Semiconductor can be broadly classified into two categories. One is intrinsic, another is extrinsic. One is intrinsic, another is extrinsic. Okay? Intrinsic means where you have not doped the material. In intrinsic material, the number of electrons and holes are same. The number of electrons and holes are same. At this point, I must tell you the difference in conductivity between a metal and a semiconductor. In metal, the current is carried by the electrons only. In semiconductor, the current is carried by both the electrons and the holes. So, that is the difference, remember. Okay? In semiconductor, the conductivity is basically bipolar in nature. Both the electrons and the holes take part in the conductivity. But in metal, only electrons take part in the conductivity, right? So, metal cannot be considered as intrinsic or extrinsic, but semiconductor, it can be intrinsic where the number of electrons and holes are same. When I talk about n, n means the number of electrons, n negative, electrons are negative. That is why n stands for the electrons. P are positive, basically P stands for positive, and P is the holes, because holes and electrons are differed by their charge. Absence of electron means holes created. Say in this case, by some means you have excited one electron and it have jumped from this valence band to conduction band, from valence band to conduction band. Okay? So, this electron which is jumped to the conduction band, what will be there here in valence band? There will be a hole. Then the electron, if moves from this place to that place, another hole will be created here. So, the conduction mechanism is in that manner, that the electron moves. If the electron moves from left to right, the hole moves from to left, right? So, in semiconductor, for intrinsic, the electrons and holes take part in the conductivity. And in intrinsic semiconductor, the number of holes equals to the number of electrons, right? But in extrinsic semiconductor, the extrinsic semiconductor is processed by doping. Intentionally, you would like to increase the number of holes or electrons in the materials, intentionally, for some reason you would like to do it, say. So, in extrinsic semiconductor, can be N type or can be P type. It can be N type or it can be P type. For N type, the number of electrons is very, very greater than number of holes. For p type, number of holes are very, very greater than number of electrons. Okay? So, that means for making an n type semiconductor, you have no other way but to dope it. Right? So, when you make some doping on a semiconductor, it becomes extrinsic, and in that case the number of electrons and number of holes are not equal. Okay? The number of electrons and number of holes are not equal, they differ in number. So, do not say that intrinsic semiconductor are the pure semiconductor, not that, all semiconductors are pure semiconductor. It is not between purity and impurity, it is between the number of electrons and holes. If they are equal, it is intrinsic. If it is different, they are extrinsic, and that can be done intentionally or unintentionally. When there is an impurity, suppose you have grown one silicon crystal and iron is there, or magnesium or sodium is there in the silicon crystal. So, that means it is impurity. Intentionally you have not done it, unintentionally during process of growth it is there. So, it will give rise to this additional line. Okay? Otherwise, if it is an n type semiconductor, then for n type semiconductor there will be a Fermi level. That Fermi level will be just below the conduction band. It is Fermi level just below the conduction band. Okay? And for p type, it is just above the valence band. Why we? Yes, we introduce Fermi level means up to that level you will find some electrons. Up to that level you will find some,
by means of excitation.
Yes, by means of excitation or without any excitation. So, that means when there is an n type semiconductor, that means only this much of energy you have to supply, only this much of energy, only this much of energy you have to supply, so that the electrons can move from the Fermi level to the conduction band. Basically, this is the donor level, basically that is the donor level. Up to that point electrons are available. So, small energy is required for excitation of the electrons from that point to the conduction band. So, that is the physical implication of Fermi level. You can do a lot of mathematics so far as the Fermi level is concerned, but that is not required in our case. Okay? So, very small amount of energy is required to excite an electron from this point to that point. Yes? Yes.
That electron will be of doped atoms or
which one?
The electron will jump from Fermi level to conduction band.
Yes.
That electron of doped atoms or?
Yes, obviously, if there is n type semiconductor, so already there is some electron. N type means that thing only. You have intentionally doped because of that reason only. Otherwise, why you will dope the semiconductor with some machine? Either diffusion is required or ion implantation is required, because for diffusion or ion implantation you need some technology, you need some money. So, if you say that there is electron, excess of electrons is required in a material, particularly in semiconductor, you have to resort to doping, and n type doping is required if you need some electrons in it, because you have injected electron in it. What is the implication of doping? Let us be very clear in it. The implication of doping is that you have to have many electrons in the material. Suppose this is a material and you need some electrons in it. From where the electrons will come? It will come from doping only. It will come from doping only. Let us take the example of silicon. Let us say one thing, that say there is silicon. Silicon. So, in silicon, you see that it is a group 4 element. So, 4 electrons are there in it, in the outermost shell. If you dope with phosphorus, phosphorus belongs to group 5 of the periodic table. So, out of those 5 electrons, 4 electrons will form covalent bond with these 4 silicon electrons, right? They will share among themselves and only one electron will be unpaired. So, that electron will be free. Very easily you can detach it from the atom. So, that is the free electron. So, if you dope say 10 to the power 12, 10 to the power 14 number of silicon with 10 to the power 14 number of phosphorus, then you will get 10 to the power 14, 10 to the power 15 number of electrons. So, that is why you dope, other is why you will dope. No, no, they are ready to jump to the conduction band if you supply that amount of energy. Yes. So, that how much energy can be supplied, that I shall discuss in my next class. Okay. So, let us conclude this session by saying that the conductivity of the metal, semiconductor and insulator basically related to the band structure of it. In metal, we have seen that they have overlapped. In insulator, the gap is very high. So, at normal room temperature, it is not possible to excite the electrons from the valence band to the conduction band. But in case of semiconductor at normal room temperature, some electrons can jump from the valence band to the conduction band because of the thermal energy associated at room temperature or from other normal sources, so that you can have electrons in the conduction band which give rise to the conductivity. And another thing is the conductivity is an intrinsic property of the material which we have seen. Okay, thank you.